Shop Talk, February special show. I'm at the Genoa station with new owner Forteno and his brother. Just bought the place, what, 6 or 7 weeks ago?
7 weeks ago.
7 weeks ago, that's a lucky number too. Now I tell you, this is one of my all-time favorite places. It just has a good feeling. Genoa is a great town. I try to do a lot of promotions myself here, so welcome to, actually you've been here for about 3 years, haven't you? You've been working here anyways?
No, actually I'm from South Lake Tahoe. And the last 12 years I was working for the MSDXC2 as a bartender. So I haven't moved to Genoa. Pretty much this is my second month.
Excellent. Awesome. I thought your brother said he worked here.
Yeah, my brother, he's the chef. He's been working here for almost 3 years.
Okay, that's why I didn't have to switch. But anyways, one of the things I like about this place, besides the ambiance, is you got a mural by Beverly Caputo right here. Do you want to get a shot there? And Beverly, she's done a number of murals in the region. One is at the Carson Valley Museum that is a whole side of the wall. Then there's one at the Sharkies. She's done a number of the Sharkies. So you have a treasured piece right there.
Yes, it is.
And then as far as coming here, has business been good so far?
Pretty much, yes. You know, some days up and down, but pretty much, especially on Tuesdays, we have Mexican food, real authentic Mexican food on Tuesdays. It's all day from noon to close. It's the most famous day.
Well, I tell you, my sister and I, we came in and couldn't believe how good the food was. It's excellent. And for directions, you're right across the street from the Genoa Bar, the oldest place in oldest bar in Nevada. And you're probably the newest first parlor in Nevada, so it's kind of a good thing. But besides Tuesdays, what else do you have going for your flow of menu?
Well, pretty much we have hamburgers, cheeseburgers, sandwiches, the traditional sandwiches such as a Reuben, pastrami's, salads, and a few specials.
Well, I also saw you going across the streets to deliver some food to some hungry people at the Thirst Parlor.
That's right.
You help out the local companies too.
Yeah, yeah. At the oldest bar, we have deliveries like appetizers and whatever they want, and we just deliver it.
So you have a takeout menu? If I called and wanted something, you could get that too?
Exactly, that's right.
So I just show up and get my bag of food?
That's right.
I like that. Well, I was talking to Chuy a little bit the other day, and he said you're also thinking about going into the pizza, having pizza as well.
Yeah, that's one of our next goals.
Excellent. Well, is there anything else you want to talk to the customers about here? Yeah, as far as entertainment, do you have like Friday entertainment? Is that one of the goals?
Actually we're working on it right now, but pretty much Fridays and Saturdays evening, yeah, we got a lot of music.
Well, it's a fun place and a fun town, and come on down to the Genoa station and enjoy their food, test it out, and I guarantee you'll like it. And I also brought some people with me that are going to do food testers, so this is not going to be an easy interview. I brought down five people to test the food out, so that's how confident these guys are. So, and we'll meet Chuy in a few minutes. Thank you very much.
plan us to go to the biggest table.
She pretty much runs the town.
Yeah,
the finances are Bridgewater. Yeah. That's kind of neat.
These are, this is our crostinis. Homemade. Little appetizer. This is our mushrooms.
Ooh.
Beer battered mushrooms. And we put a little bit of Parmesan cheese on and ranch dressing on the side.
Wonderful. And what's that, chef? What's that there?
This one here is crostinis.
Crostinis.
This is, it's a toasted bread with tomatoes, basil, garlic, spices, and mozzarella cheese on top.
Oh, that looks so good. I'm going to eat some of that.
And I'll be back with the other ones.
Okay.
Very good. Oh wow, very nice. The mushroom thing is really great.
Tacos al pastor made with chicken, right here. Homemade salsa and rice and beans. Right here we have chicken enchiladas. Mm. Authentic.
I can tell by your accent.
And I'll be back with other stuff.
Very good. The mushroom chef.
Yes.
Very nice. So very, very good.
What do you think of the crostini?
Very unique.
Yeah?
I like it. I like it.
Okay. Yeah, most places they make it with really, really crunchy bread.
Mm-hmm.
It's different.
Yeah.
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 Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. We have fish tacos, Baja style, which is a light bread, tilapia, deep fried, and lemon cream sauce.
Ooh.
On top, which we forgot about that. Now we have tacos al pastor. This is pork. And it's almost the same thing as the chicken, but different taste, different flavors.
Do you put a different sauce on that too?
Different marinade.
Marinade, oh, I see, yeah. Very nice.
Okay, now we have our chile rellenos, homemade from this morning. we use pasilla peppers and stuffed with queso fresco and mozzarella cheese. And again, homemade rice and beans.
Very nice. Where did you study? Where did you learn how to cook?
I went to the South Lake Tahoe Community College.
Oh, wonderful.
10 years ago.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah. And you know, also working on a different places.
Yeah.
The casinos up at the bay, down here in Carson City, Carson Valley Inn, at
the fish tacos, that's always the kind of love you have fish tacos.
We got to try this on the fish tacos, that's it. Lemon cream sauce.
Lemon cream sauce.
Yes.
And it looks like...
Yes.
just something different.
I bet you do. This is anybody interested in a fish taco? And then here's the money cream sauce.
And here's
Swiss tacos. Plates.
Tacos al pastor.
Now, is anybody here for that fish taco? Here's the lemon cream sauce, okay?
This one, the fish taco? Yes.
No, I did want some of that.
Wonderful. Do you want to try the
chicken?
This was the pork taco.
That's the pork.
He
says it's for the
pizza. Very good.
Welcome.
Hi.
How you guys here today?
No, no, that's not.
And this is for our customer right here, Tacos Al Pastor. He comes in every time and he loves our tacos.
Pork.
And this.
Pork is good, yeah?
Okay, now we have our bread pudding in Spanish capirotada. It's homemade with some chocolate sauce and strawberry sauce, which is homemade too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, Alice, thank you very much, sir. It's a pleasure to meet you. Since it's been open for 7 weeks now.
Yes, starts on after the Cabo Poultry. We're going to start open Mondays from 11 to 7:30.
And you mentioned possibly you'd be hiring someone for a breakfast menu as well.
Yes, we're going to start serving breakfast on Thursday at 8 a.m. through Sunday. So 8 a.m. to 11:30 every day.
Excellent. Well, one thing I like about this place, besides your variety of spices and things you use, and is your attitude. You and Forteno are so happy.
Thank you.
Really, I mean, yes. you can't fake the happiness. And like I said, one reason I wanted to come back and shoot you guys is the passion you have bringing to a new business.
Mm-hmm.
And it's exciting right now to have a new business in this little area. Genoa is a special area, and you belong here. So
when
we get done in a few minutes, when our people are done eating, we'll have them see what the results are.
Okay, sounds good.
The chef at Genoa Station, we just had 5 food tasters test your wares, Chuy, and now we'll find out from Israel what his opinion is.
Okay.
Hola, muchas gracias por invitarnos. La comida es exquisita. Les deseo mucha suerte y mucho éxito a ti y a tu hermano, que lo conozco desde hace mucho tiempo. Muchas gracias.
Okay, gracias.
Wendy Fox.
I just absolutely love the food, everything from the appetizers. I tried the mushroom appetizers, and I love the meals. I tried the chicken enchilada. It was wonderful. And your dessert was outstanding, the bread pudding. Highly recommended.
Thank you.
Phil Prunier.
Well, I loved the fish tacos, and it was unique, the sauce that you had. Was a lemon
cream sauce.
Lemon cream sauce, fantastic. I would suggest that. And it was the perfect dessert too. The bread pudding. What a way to go to end the meal.
It's fantastic.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Isaac Fox.
Put it simply, it's very good food.
Okay. Deborah J. Bucky.
Fantastic. Every food had its own distinct flavor, and it was all just fantastic. I would come back again.
Honestly, I didn't find a food critic here. They all loved your work, which is, I love it too.
Thank you. Thank you.
And lastly, Forteno was going to say about the Sundays.
Sweet Sipping Sundays. Start the next week. People pay $15 for first glass. And then every Sunday, every Sunday of the first month, they get a free shot. So come over and try your station.
Pony Express,
yes. It's going to be made with a tequila. So
excellent. Yeah, well, I had your margarita was excellent, and thank you very much. And you also have some specials, I understand, about the strawberry as well.
Yeah, today we have a strawberry guava margarita. And pretty much, every kind of cocktails that you guys like.
I want to try
pretty much have a food bar.
Excellent. Well, I'd like to personally thank you two for bringing this into your lives, and we wish you much success in your new business, and I hope you're here for many, many years.
Bravo.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Genoa Station, Genoa. Enjoy.
Thanks.
Let's put it on Facebook.
If you had not fallen, I would not have found you. Angel flying too close to the ground. I patched up your broken wings and I hung around for a while, trying to keep your spirits up and your fever down. So leave me if you need to. I will still remember. Angel flying too close to the ground.
Wonderful food. Now I'm going to do a tune by, let's see, that I usually do in my show about the fifth set. Tune by Van Morrison.
We were born before the wind, also younger than the sun. Our bonny boats were won into the mystic. Hark now, hear the sailors cry. Smell the sea and touch the sky. Together we will fly into the mystic. When that foghorn whistle blows, I will be coming home.
adventurous stories. And she has the books available and working on her third.
That's correct, yes.
So how did you get started writing children's books?
Well, I started, or I meant long story short, I started out with my husband. We do like the wilderness sports, and I started writing articles in the Nevada Appeal. At that time it was called Go for the Great Outdoors. We would go out on some really cool snowmobile riding and also dog sledding. So I'd write about our adventure and put it in the paper so that people, especially families, would know about all the great stuff you can do out there. You know, if you're not aware, there's a lot of fun stuff up like Tahoe area, you know, by Truckee. So then my mom came to me one day and said, Mary, I think that you should write children's adventure books because you'd be so good at it with your wild imagination. Because I had such a great childhood growing up in the hills of Fairfax near San Rafael in California, and I used to tell stories to all the kids, and just they just love that. We do have great adventures up there. So I started writing the first book, which I titled A Walk Through the Woods, and when I was starting to write it, I told my mom, Mom, I said, you are right. I love this. Thank you so much for pointing me in the right direction. So I thank my mom for pointing me into the right direction. I just love what I'm doing now.
And the book takes place in Jackson, Kentucky.
Right.
How did you pick Jackson, Kentucky?
I just picked the name, and I think there really is a Jackson in Kentucky, but I didn't know it at the time. So I picked the name Jackson, Kentucky, where his parents had their business. Bobby's the main character. And he always is wearing his lucky baseball cap, and that's his parents have a business there in Jackson, but he's staying in Benton, Kentucky, which is a little town in the outside of Jackson with his grandma, Lizzie. And
there are other children in the book.
His best friends.
His best friends.
Yes.
And the animals. What can you tell us about the characters?
Sure. Is it okay if I pick it
sure.
up? Is that all right? He all of a sudden he walks through the woods every day on the way to school. All of a sudden these animals start to approach him, and it turns out they talk, and he encounters Priscilla the deer is the first one. Then after that he runs across Rudy the raccoon, and then Andre the skunk, and Bongo the bobcat, and then Baldassar the golden eagle. He's the keeper of the magic kingdom in the woods, and he and his best friends. But they're the only ones that are able to hear the animals speak because of their innocence and their belief in magic. So grown-ups cannot hear the animals speak, only the children, because of their belief in magic and their innocence. So the animals lead them on a great journey. They meet a friend whose name is Honest Abe. And it kind of like, it's funny because it makes you think of Honest Abe, the president way back when, but he just has that name because he's a very honest person. His buddies gave him that name. He oversees these great caves, and there's relics of the Civil War in these caves. And he takes the kids there and kind of teaches them about the different things they see in there. And there's ghosts of the Civil War, ghosts of Indians. And these ghosts lead him also to find this treasure that was buried during the Civil War. And he also, he and his kids are very good at BMX bike riding, and he and the kids and the animals get on this big BMX bike riding down this valley called the Valley of the Wild Boar. And then they also encounter these villains on dirt bikes, motocross bikes, that try to take over these caves, and they, you know, but the kids, in the end, the kids win, and they get them out of there.
Do the kids help from the animals getting
rid
of the villains?
Yes, they do. They have a lot of help from the animals getting rid of these villains, absolutely. Oh.
And you said you do a lot of historical research.
Yes.
Like the Civil War, so you teach as well as the adventure.
That is correct. That is correct, Colleen. What I do is, even though all the books are adventure, they're fictional, they're adventure, they're magic, mystery, and fantasy. I also research each area, so there's actual history in each book, so the kids can learn from that about the history of the area.
That's amazing. And that takes us to the second adventure. You still have the same main character?
Yes.
And there's still some wild names in this one.
Yes, there are. Like Bobby, he still has his lucky baseball cap. He's still the main character throughout all three stories. And here he's either skateboarding, and this one he's doing a pop shove it on a skateboard. And he meets new kids over there, which also become very good friends of his. And he encounters Yoli, the mystical, magical purple mermaid, who directs them in the right direction to, and tells them how what they have to go through to find the kids call them Jalalapop, but the Aborigines call them Wadiaruru, because this takes place over in Queensland, Australia. That's where he goes in the second adventure with his parents. And Jalalapop is half kangaroo and on top and half dragon on the bottom. And he watches over and protects all the children and animals throughout the whole continent of Australia. And he's the one that helps when they find him. There's things they have to go through in order to find him, tasks they must perform. And the animals, the talking animals in Australia, they talk Aussie, and they lead them also to the how to get to this mermaid. And then she directs them to someone in a magic closet to get to, for the task they have to perform to get to the half kangaroo, half dragon, Jalalapop. And he's the one that helps them defeat those villains over there that are trying to take over something that happens in the northern Queensland outback after a comet hits there.
And there are Aborigines that you talk about in this book. Do they help the animals and the kids?
Yes, they also help the animals and the kids. And one particular Aborigine, his name is Tutu Wampka, but the kids call him Tutu, and he's a big help throughout the story, helping them throughout the whole journey.
And you're writing a trilogy. What's the common thread that Bobby is trying to find at the end of the trilogy?
What he is trying, what the animals and the people he meets along the way, like in this case, Honest Abe in the first story, and then Tutu Wampka in the second story, what they're trying to direct him to do is that there's something he must do. He's on a quest, and he must find his destiny. They're leading him on his destiny so that he can make a very important change in the 21st century, to change something very important to help all of mankind and all of the animals and people on Earth.
Your third book takes place in Siberia,
northern Russia.
And I asked, is that happening in the winter?
It's actually happening in June, because when the children get out of school, his dad takes Bobby and his best friend Molly from the first story in Kentucky over to Siberia, and it's during the month of June, so in Russia they also have their summer, but their summers are a lot cooler than our summers here, so they have to dress warm. But up in northeastern Siberia, where they're going, there's still a little snow on the ground in some places, and they meet Yakuts, native Yakuts up there, who also help them on their journey, help Bobby on his journey, and they're going to introduce him to a shaman who's going to be the one to lead him to find this one particular area where he's going to actually come up against some evil beings. But that's where he's going to make where he meets his destiny and does the right thing to make this change in the 21st century. And it's also about innocence and doing the right thing and believing in magic.
Right.
And all the things that go along with it.
And I remember too that you had two little dogs in the fire tale. What was this one's? He had a British name.
Yes, the little dog who's a Maltese belongs to the children he meets over in Australia, in Queensland, Australia, near Brisbane, and their dog's name is Bosworth.
He's, I love that.
Bosworth.
And then where did the German Shepherd come from?
The German Shepherd, Bobby, there's a neighbor that lived down the road from where his parents have rented this home over there in Queensland. And he, the man finds out from his parents how much he loves animals. And he didn't have a dog of his own in Kentucky. So he has one German Shepherd left out of the litter. And he gives it to Bobby. He's already close to, he's only about 6 months old. And Bobby names him Roni. So Roni and Bosworth become best friends, and they go with the children on their journeys, on their journey to find this Jalalapop.
So will we see either one of these in Siberia?
Roni will be going to Siberia with Bobby and his Molly and his dad.
Oh my goodness. How do you pick the regions that you stage your stories?
I don't know how I do it. I just kind of places that kind of intrigue me. Like I was telling, like Colleen, like we were talking earlier, Kentucky, I used to go on many vacations with my mom and dad because my grandparents lived in Michigan and New York. So we would go I'd get out of school, my parents would be off from their jobs, and we'd travel by automobile across the whole United States, and my dad would pick the different places along the way. Yes. So Kentucky was one of my favorite states. I remember I got to go, we got to go through Mammoth Caves, Kentucky, and that stuck in my mind, so I thought, for the first book, that'd be so cool for kids to experience that. Even though there's three caves in my book, and it's not Mammoth Caves or different caves, it's, you know, fictional fantasy, but yet it's kind of like the Mammoth Caves in Kentucky. And I was always intrigued by Australia, especially Queensland, so that'd be really cool for him to go over there and experience all these really cool things over there. And I've always been also fascinated by Russia and Siberia, so that'd be a great place to have him go in his trilogy, third book.
So have you been to Australia?
No, I haven't been to Australia or Siberia. Kentucky I have, but not Australia or Siberia. But I do all this research through the internet, which is like a wealth of knowledge through the internet. And the Carson City Library, I just researched the whole area. So by the time I get done, I feel like I've been to Queensland, Australia, and I feel like I'm in Siberia right now.
Oh my gosh, that's great. You do have an imagination. I was intrigued by how you go through the process of writing a book.
Oh, okay. Okay. What I do, I think that's what we were talking about earlier. I just, first I do all this research, and then once I get all my notes down for the research part of the area, then I go in and just let my imagination take over, and I blend the history in with the story, the fictional adventure fantasy story. I blend it all in together, so it's like it blends right in. And what I do is I sit down, I have a comfortable chair in the living room, I just sit down with my notebook, and I start writing. I just let my imagination just pour out, and I just start writing like crazy, and the stuff just really comes to me. Fortunately, I knock on wood, I haven't had an experience with writer's block, and I hope I never do, but I just get in there and let my imagination take over. I start writing everything down on the notebook. Once I'm done with that, and I check all the spelling and read it over, then I go into my computer on Microsoft Word. I type the whole thing into Microsoft Word, and then I read it over again and check everything. Then I send it over to my husband, Alan, on the email, and he backs it up, and then he prints only that chapter out, and then he edits it and proofreads it and makes any corrections, because he's very good at spelling and punctuation. So I feel very lucky to have Alan to do that.
And you're self-published.
And I'm self-published.
And you had a book signing this last summer,
Evergreen Jeans? Yes.
In Carson City.
Uh-huh. And it all began in March of last year when I heard their advertisement on, it was on the Cowboy Station, Cowboy Country, and also the regular 103.7, whom I listened to on the Rock Station, and they announced they were going to have an arts and craft fair. So I thought, gosh, maybe I should try to see if I could do a book signing there. So I called Gene from Evergreen Jeans, and he put me through over to Sandy Lene. Uh-huh. She's such a sweetheart, and we became good friends. And she got me in on that March book signing with the little arts and crafts show. Uh-huh. Then we did one in the summer for Pink Day last year. Then we did one in the fall in November, and that's where I met Michael Smith.
That's great, right?
Right. And got to talking
with
him.
He's behind the camera.
He's behind the camera today. He's our cameraman.
So hopefully you will have your third book done by?
I'm trying real hard, hopefully, to have it done by December of this year. So I'm crossing my fingers and working real hard to try to get that done.
And how can people find your books?
They can either contact me, because I have a good supply at home. They can contact me on my email or phone number, home phone number, because I have a message phone. And if they get them through me, you get author's discount, and I'll sign them for you, get a bookmark and everything. Or if they can't do that, they can also get them online through Amazon.com, BarnesandNoble.com, and my publisher, ExLibris.com.
There you go. And again, that's Mary Randall. And her two books that are written already, A Walk Through the Woods in Jackson, Kentucky, and In the Fire Tale.
It's called Fire in the Tale.
Oh, Fire in the Tale. They
put this part kind of small, but Fire in the Tale.
Okay.
That's okay, because this part
is
kind of small.
My depth perception is off. And tell us again the names of, I just love the names you came up with.
Mermaid. And the mermaid is Yoli, the mystical, magical purple mermaid.
And say that three times fast.
Well, I know it. That'd be a good one to stop. Stop. Hiccups.
Oh, there you go. Or start them.
Or start them. One of the two. And then the other creature that's the kind of like the heroine of the book is Jalalapop. The kids call him Jalalapop, and the Aborigines call him Wadiaruru. He's half kangaroo on top and half dragon on the bottom.
And if they email you, can you give out your email?
Sure, absolutely. I'd be happy
and
to.
What is it?
And it's all lowercase. It's Rusty, R-U-S-T-Y, the, T-H-E, author, A-U-T-H-O-R. That's Rusty, the author, at yahoo.com.
Oh, perfect. So you would arrange to sign the book.
Sure.
Give them a little bookmark and talk about the book. Probably sign it over to a child.
Yes.
With his name.
I would
name.
Love to. I'd be more than happy to.
Awesome.
I just love that.
So I would love to carry your books at Bridger Mountain.
Thank
so
you, Colleen.
So bring me some.
Absolutely.
Maybe at Christmas time we could have a book signing.
Oh, that'd be great. I'd love that. It'd be so
that
much
would be
fun.
We would love that.
I would love that too. Thank you.
Okay, Rusty the author
at
yahoo.com. Thank you. Welcome to Shop Talk. I'm here this afternoon with Sherry Rupert. Hi, Sherry.
Hi.
Sherry is the coordinator for the, and you'll have to help me say this, the sesquicentennial Stewart Father's Day Powwow.
Yes.
You're also the executive director for
the Nevada Indian Commission.
And what does that entail?
So I am the liaison for Governor Sandoval to our 27 tribal nations in the state of Nevada.
Oh my goodness.
Yes.
And how big is that territory? Is it the whole state?
It's the entire state.
Oh my gosh. And how many, you said 27.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to travel there in a 3-day period, could you see them all? Or
That would be very difficult to do. It takes probably about a week to get around the state. Our tribes are very rural. There are a few that are urban, but for the most part, they're in the rural areas of Nevada. We do have tribes throughout Nevada. Predominantly, our tribes are in northern Nevada, but we do have southern Nevada tribes. And then the highest population of American Indians is in Clark County in southern Nevada.
And we talked about the fact that the culture is just steeped. It's just deep. And the powwow, if you've never been to a powwow, it fills you up. And what I see on your flyer are the warriors in the front. And what is their position? Are they... Have they been in battle? Have they?
Right. The warriors that bring the flags in at the grand entry, which is the beginning of the event, are our warriors, are our veterans that have been, in our armed forces. And they're very important to us as cultural people. They are our warriors. And so we at the Stewart Father's Day Powwow, we try to honor them as best we can. We do an honor song for our veterans on Father's Day to thank them for all of everything that they've done for us, all of the sacrifices that they and their families have made. So they are very important to us. In this particular photo, it's the Pyramid Lake Paiute Tribe's warrior organization, and we have them come down and participate every year.
And they're... I called them costumes, but the proper word is?
Regalia.
Regalia.
Yes, I think that's very important because these are not just costumes that you put on for an event. This is regalia. This is a part of you. These items, these feathers, are spiritual to us as Indian people, and they're living and breathing, and we take care of them. Mm. So it's not just a costume.
That's right. And you told me that this was an eagle staff?
It is. Yeah, that's our flag as Native people, the Eagle Staff. And again, a spiritual item that is with us to protect us and to help us through the event.
It's just beautiful. Lots of beadwork. The feathers here.
Those aren't actually like feathers. Those are porcupine quills.
Wow.
And so that particular piece on the top of the gentleman's head there is called a roach. And then he's a traditional dancer, so he would probably have eagle feathers and hawk feathers on his outfit.
And other dancers who wear the moccasins, mm-hmm. the fancy dancers you called them,
mm-hmm.
what else do they have on their...
So this gentleman here on my left-hand side...
Who happens to be...
My husband. he is a fancy dancer, and so he does wear moccasins, and then he wears angora fur around the calf area, and then just above that he has the bells that are very predominant. You know, when you come out to the powwow, that's one of the things, you know, if you were to sit there with your eyes closed, you could hear all of the bells.
Right. Mm-hmm. You could also hear the drums.
Yes.
And what do the drums mean?
The drums are, to us, it's more of a heartbeat. Again, that drum is living and breathing and is a part of us. And so when you're drumming, that is the heartbeat, and so you're drawn to that. And it's just really special to be there. If you have the opportunity and you do come to the powwow, I would really encourage you to come and sit by one of the drums and just to feel that beat and how it just draws you in. It's really amazing.
And the powwow will be June 13th through 15th. And what other events will be going on at the same time?
Sure. Not only do we have the powwow there, but we also, in building number one, which we're looking at establishing a cultural center, we have an exhibit there. The exhibit are items from the school, the memorabilia from the school. So the Nevada State Museum houses that for us, and they bring in an exhibit that we can share with the public. We also have information in that building about our plans for the Stewart Indian School, not only for the cultural center, but for the welcome center and eventually a destination experience. We also have alumni that are housed in there. We do an area for them to come in. They bring their old photos, they decorate, they even have their music in there from the day, you know, when they were at the school. It's an opportunity for them to, we have them sign in because we'd like to know who's there. They get an opportunity to share with each other, to reminisce about their time at the school. We also have photos in there that they can help us identify who are in those old photos. And then we also have a Stewart Father's Day Powwow Princess contest that will be going on. We usually decide that on Saturday. We have a raffle. We have a silent auction that's going on all throughout the powwow.
It's great fun.
And I didn't mention the vendors.
Oh, vendors.
We have about 50 vendors that come out, and they have a whole range of items that they sell. So for what we call the arts and crafts vendors or artisans, they'll sell things like basketry, beadwork, rugs, jewelry is a big thing. And then we also have our food vendors. And we have minimum, you know, 4 taco vendors. They are very popular.
Yes.
A lot of people I talk to, one of the main reasons why they come out is for the Indian tacos.
And the fried bread. And you say beadwork. I'm looking at part of the regalia here, and on his arms are cuffs. Are those solid beadwork?
So what that is it's usually the backing is buckskin,
mm-hmm.
and then they bead over the top of the buckskin. It's very intricate work. It's very detailed, and really it takes a great creative eye to be able to do that because you have to line all the beads up just perfectly, mm-hmm. and I mean, it's an art.
And they're tiny.
They're very tiny cut glass beads.
These are all beads also.
Thousands of beads in that one collar there.
That's amazing. I watched a lady making the little pine needle baskets. And what else do they make baskets from?
They also make baskets out of willows, which are, grow here in the state of Nevada. Our American Indian tribes were very adept at adapting to their resources in the area. And so they made baskets for usage, for utilitarian needs. And so they would weave these baskets, and they had, as I said, different uses. And some were winnowing baskets, some were burden baskets, where you would fill up with pine cones when you're out pine nut picking. There were baskets for water, where you would put the pine pitch around it so it would enclose in the water, so the water wouldn't leak out.
I watched a man making rugs, and he explained that he had actually carded, cut the sheep's wool, carded it, cleaned it, dyed it, spun it, and then he was weaving gorgeous rugs. Will they have those there also?
You know, I can't say for sure. He's usually there, and we welcome, our vendors back every year. But the great thing about the powwow is that we do get, new vendors in and out every year.
And you said that a couple comes from Idaho that brings supplies for vendors.
Right. Not only do they bring supplies, but they bring beautiful beadwork from Idaho. But they do. They bring hides.
Beads.
Furs and beads and things like that that they can sell to other artisans for their continued work.
So is there anything else that you would like to share about the council that you're on, or the powwow?
Sure. I also sit on the Nevada Sesquicentennial Commission, and our powwow has been designated as a signature event of the Sesquicentennial. So we are incorporating the celebration of Nevada's 150th birthday into this year's powwow. Our princess, for example, will be designated as the Sesquicentennial Stewart Father's Day Powwow Princess. Every Sunday, we give out Father's Day cake to all of our fathers. But this year, we'll also have a Sesquicentennial birthday cake for everybody. So, it's a great event. It's a family event. It's free to the public. We want people to know that it's a safe place to come to bring your families, and it is an alcohol and drug-free event. We welcome everybody to come and learn about the culture and to support us as the powwow and as the Indian Commission in our efforts to preserve the history of the Stewart Indian School.
That's beautiful. And how do they find Snyder Avenue, 5500 Snyder Avenue?
So if you were coming on the bypass from Reno, you would get off on Fairview, which is the very last stop. You could turn left on to Fairview, and then right onto Edmonds, and follow Edmonds all the way down to Snyder, mm-hmm. make a right, and then the school's on the left-hand side. If you were to get off on Fairview and make a right-hand turn, you would hit Carson Street, mm-hmm. make a left, and you would turn left on Clearview, because Snyder is closed off of the highway right now. So there is a detour, and so you turn left on Clearview, and then make a right on Ponderosa, and then that will lead you to Snyder.
So, and you will see and hear the event going on. And the Stewart facility, they're trying to rehab it and bring back the museum. Will that be coming back?
Well, what we're doing is it's owned right now by the state of Nevada, mm-hmm. and so we're working to establish a cultural center in building number one, which was the former administration building. We also would like to have a welcome center, mm-hmm. to welcome people out to Stewart. People get lost out there all the time because there are so many buildings, and so we want to be able to tell people about the history of the school. We want to be able to share that history. But long term, we're looking at having a cultural heritage destination. where people can have come actually and have the experience of what it was like for these children to be taken away from their families. A lot of people aren't aware of what these Indian boarding schools were and how it affected our Indian people and their relationship with education. And so this particular school was established in 1890 and closed in 1980 and was established to assimilate our Indian children into a different culture. And so these children were taken away at very young ages. When they got to the school, they were unable to speak any of their languages or practice any of their cultural traditions. And so what we want to do is we want to tell that story. We want people to experience that, and so that's what we're working toward.
How do they contact you to find out more?
They can go to our dedicated website, stewartindianschool.com, all one word, or they can give us a call at the Indian Commission at 687-8333.
And we will have posters. Look for them all over town. Please come to the powwow. It is great, family, safe, fun. And we will have a poster at Bridger Mountain inside the Carson Mall. And we are going to post some more of these around the mall. So watch for this very colorful and very, there's a lot of information on here. I'm sorry that you can't read it on the air, but come on into the shop and take a peek. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead. Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming. Fed to the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets smart but your head gets dumb. So much to do, so much to see. So what's wrong with taking the back streets? You'll never know if you don't go. You'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on, get paid. And they say it gets colder. You're bundled up now, wait till you get older. But the media men beg to differ, judging by the hole in the satellite picture. The ice we skate is getting pretty thin. The water's getting warm, so you might as well swim. My world's on fire, how about yours? That's the way I like it and I'll never get bored. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on, get paid.
Thank you.